mechanical in vivo performance of devices made with additive manufacturing technology, in particular with laser and with ABM technology. In Eurocoating, we are building for the medical market several different devices, as you can see, spinal component, cups, a lot of cups, and tibia tray and cranial plate, some big, large custom device for the hip, wedge, trauma plate, screw, and so on. As you probably know, the two processes are pretty different. The ABM one is an high energy, high vacuum, high temperature process. And Eurocoating, we are equipped to work with titanium 64 and also with grade 2 and cobalt chromium. The laser process, on the other hand, is a low energy process if compared to the other one, low temperature, and works in a protective atmosphere. And Eurocoating is able to work with titanium 64, pure titanium, stainless steel 74 pH, and cobalt chromium. All the material that we use here in house are completely qualified and completely in agreement with the specs for the medical market. In particular, we take care of the oxygen content for the titanium 64 that has to be acceptable also after the reuses of the material. Here an example of the performance, mechanical performance of the material in agreement with STMF 136. So, going directly to the core of the presentation, is the EM process the right manufacturing process for the medical devices? We have to consider different points. The first one is the economical point. Not all the devices are suitable to be built with additive manufacturing process. You have to remember that this is a quite expensive process if compared to other processes, so you have to choose the right device that can use all the advantages coming from this kind of technologies. Also, not all the devices are economically convenient with the AM. This means okay, I switch the first point and the second point. Okay, this means that the first point means that not all the AM process are economically convenient for all the devices. So you have to choose the right process for the right device. Okay, and also, as I already said, not all the devices are suitable for AM, economically speaking. So you have to choose the right process and the right part, and you will have the right cost. So there is also other point connected with the design. We know that additive manufacturing is a process that deletes some design constraint that you can have with other processes. So when you design a part, you have to keep in mind that this part would be made using additive manufacturing. So, to use at the maximum level the additive manufacturing possibility, you have to think, for example, about the light structure or foam-made device, something that is not possible with other technologies. And finally, you have to consider that the AM process can be validated and that on the shelf there is already several products, both in US and in Europe, made with AM, with the CE mark, and or with the FDA clearance. So at the end, with the right design, with the right choose of the process, and with the fact that the process can be validated, you will have a successful device. Obviously, not a simple shape, but as complex as possible. Okay, going to the foam testing we perform a in vivo test on a random organic foam. We choose the same foam, the same geometry of the foam, both for ABM and for laser, but we decide to go close to the limit of the technology. So with the laser, we try to build foam with a strat about 150 microns. And with the ABM, we try to go to the limit. And this limit for this kind of foam was about 1.6 times larger than the foam made with the laser. We used the GOAT model, and each animal received both an ABM and a laser-made part. This is an example of one of the samples we use in this kind of experiment. So each animal, as I told you, received both the samples. And actually, an animal receives cylindrical samples for push-out test and flat samples for histomorphometric and histological analysis. As you can see in the picture, each sample was made by two plates, one made with ABM, one made with laser, linked together and implanted in the same location. Both the technology were used with the conventional post-processing steps we are used to apply in Eurocoating. So the ABM surface was sandblasted and decontaminated, mainly washed, and the laser surface was sandblasted and then cleaned with an acid process. Okay, something about the foam. The ABM foam has a porosity about 50% and has pores in the range of 350 microns and 1,400 microns. And the layer of the porous and the porous layer is 1.5 millimeter thick. The laser foam, even if built with the same CAD file, let's say, appear slightly different because the porosity is slightly over 60% and the pore size range is smaller than the ABM, so 250-800 microns. On the other hand, the layer thickness is a bit higher, probably due to an error in the preparation of the file. Okay, so the target of this experiment was to demonstrate osteointegration and osteoconductive potential of this kind of trabecular-like structures, and to show the capability to enhance the bone growth. So, as I told you, we used the GOAT model. We implanted the flat samples in the femoral condyle of the GOAT and the cylindrical sample for the push-out in the iliac crest. We use a group of 14 GOAT, and we sacrificed half of the GOAT at 4 weeks and the other half at 15 weeks. Here's some result. I'm not a biologist, so let me speak in any as a not expert person. We tested the bone-to-implant contact and the bone growth. So we tested the amount of bone in direct contact with the implant versus the total surface of the implant and the depth of the penetration of the bone inside the lattice structure. And then we made analysis of the load that we have to apply to have the cylinder detaching from the bone. So here are some pictures of the actual samples. As you can see, on one side there is a foam made with the laser, and the other side the foam made with ABM. And here are some results. It's evident that the bone is strictly in contact with the foam, and at 4 weeks you can see woven bone inside the pores, and healthy bone in the area close to the implant. One thing that we noticed is that in some samples made with DBM, there is some residual of beads inside the pores in the deeper part of the foam. But actually, these beads are not loosened because they are slightly welded to the implant, and we have no evidence of particle release from these samples in the body of the goat. So we have the thought that even if the cleaning is an issue with the ABM structure, actually it is not so risky condition because these loosened particles are not released in the body. This is some result after 15 weeks, more or less the same. So the bone continued to grow close to the implant and inside the pores, and the bone is still healthy close to the device. Coming to the numbers, here you can see the ingrow depth and the bone-to-implant contact. As you can see, there is an increase in the ingrow depth and also in the bone-to-implant contact from 4 to 15 weeks. And it means that the bone is healthy and continue to grow. Another point is that there is no statistical differences between the behavior of the ABM samples or the laser samples. So, from a biological point of view, for what we can see here, the choice can be made without any precondition with the laser or with ABM. Here are some results about the push-out test. So we have the same conclusion. There is no statistical difference between ABM and laser, and the load that we have to apply is increased after 15 weeks if compared to the 4 weeks. So at the end, both ABM and the MLS structure showed good bone ingrow and high osteoconductivity. The mechanical strength reached at the bone interface was comparable between all the different samples and between the two technology. And it was increased between 4 and 15 weeks. So at the end, we can say that both the processes are effective and are able to enhance and accelerate bone ingrow thanks to the 3D highly interconnected porous structure. So what's next? Obviously, the technology has some limits. For example, the laser technology is low if compared to the ABM, and the ABM technology is not so accurate. Also, for ABM, this is the issue of the cleaning. So it is very difficult. It is, I think, a challenge to clean a foam that is more than 1.5 millimeter thick without processes that can affect also the mechanical strength of the foam itself. We had the experience in cleaning 10 millimeter thick foam, and we are able to clean the foam, but on the other hand, the external surface of the foam was seriously damaged by the cleaning process. So what's next? For the laser, we are concentrating the effort in high thickness foam building, and we are working to improve the manufacturing speed of this technology. On the other hand, for ABM, we are focusing on large devices, and thanks to a project financed by the European Community, we are trying to fill the gap between the resolution of the ABM technology and the laser one with a research project called High Resolution ABM, with other partners, obviously not by ourselves. Finally, can IEM be considered a process suitable for medical device manufacturing? The answer is yes. because the material properties are in agreement with the standard, because there is already a device on the shelf in US and Europe, because that technology, with the possibility to build a highly 3D structure, porous structure, can enhance and accelerate the bone and grow. Because with the foam-like structures, you can play with the surface roughness. You can have smooth surfaces, even if porous, or with a high grip effect to improve the primary fixation. You can remove some design limitation, and also you have an economically sustainable process if well designed and projected. And obviously, future improvement can only make it more and more interesting. And that's all. Thank you for your attention.
Great. Thank you, Emmanuel. At this time, I'm going to try and field some questions. I have a microphone that I'll bring around, and hopefully it'll pick up. So, Emmanuel, you can hear the questions. Let's see if this works.
Okay, please speak slowly because your voice is quite loudly.
Are there any questions?
Emanuele, this is Dr. Rouse, and I wanted to tell you that I was very disappointed when I found your trip had been canceled. And I'm glad you took our advice to do this electronically, because I think the presentation that you gave us this morning answered questions that arose in this group this morning. And it was excellently done, and it's very valuable to all of us. I want to say thank you.
Okay. Thank you for thank you for that. I'm sorry not to be there, as you can imagine.
I had a question. What applications do you see for the titanium alloy in the medical area?
What application I can see? Let's say, from my point of view, a titanium alloy can be used for almost all the device. The most important thing is to keep in mind the technology possibility, this kind of technology possibility when you have to design a device. So it is mainly a problem of mind freedom. I'm not a designer of device, I'm a technical engineer, I'm process engineer. But I know that this kind of process can help deleting some limits that we had in the past. And I'm working with some customer to design, let's say, a special device that has the will to be used as processes that at the moment doesn't exist.
Other questions?
Well, I have a question about the limitation of these two techniques in your conclusion. You mentioned the limitation for these two techniques. One is the speed is limited, the other one is the accuracy is limited. In your opinion, could you give us some thoughts on the reasons on these limitations respectively?
Can you repeat? Because it is too noisy.
So my question is, for these two techniques, there are some limitations mentioned in your conclusion. So in terms of the manufacturing speed and manufacturing accuracy for these two processes respectively, so I'm wondering whether you could give us some thoughts on the reasons of the or what type of thresholds or what type of bottlenecks are limiting these two techniques to be so accurate or to be fast enough.
Okay, if I understood correctly, you are asking about the definition and the detail that we that are possible to be built, to be created with this technology. Is it right?
Yes.
For the these two techniques you mentioned, one is not fast enough, and I'm wondering what the reason, in your opinion. And the other technique you mentioned is not so accurate, and I'm also wondering the reason for that. And do you think these two techniques can be improved in these two aspects?
Okay, so you asking about the negative point I underlined, so the speed of the production speed and the details I can obtain, right? I'm pretty sure that the production speed will increase quite fast in the next future, because the different manufacturer of the AM building machine are working very hard on that field, and as you probably saw during the exposition, there is new model of the Arcam machine, for example, the Q10, or a new model of the laser machine with 400 watts laser or bigger, that are going in that direction. So the productivity of this kind of technology is increasing very fast, and I think that in the next future we will reach a relative good productivity, even if not comparable to the productivity of a turning machine, for example. But on the other hand, we can achieve result completely different from a turning machine. We can merge the advantages of the turning machine with plasma coating, for example, in the same object. So on one side, the building the additive manufacturing technology is a slow building technology. But on the other hand, if you take a look at the whole process, from the design to the final part, it is not so slow. Okay. Talking about the definition, the resolution, I'm pretty sure that we are in the next future. We will see machine able to build the details very small and smaller if compared to the one that we can see at the moment. But we have also to consider that for the medical market, at least, and for the creation of foam, probably there is not a lot of need to go below 0.1 or 0.05 millimeter of resolution. You have to consider that if you want mechanical connection with other device, you have anyway to machine and to post-process the surface, because the surface is rough. So I don't think that these points have to be increased so much. So let's say for the EBM there is the need to have a better resolution, and for the laser there is the need to have a higher production speed. But what I can say talking with the machine producer is that we are working in that direction, and in the next future we will see something better than now.
Thank you.
I have a question about the phone structure. Has anybody used the phone structure in the classic APEC? And if so, what are the benefits of using phone structure in the classic APEC?
Can you repeat? There is too much noise. Sorry, I'm really sorry.
Okay, my question was, has anybody used the foam structure in the plastic implant? And if so, what are the benefits of using the foam structure?
No, what is the question? Sorry
okay.
Again.
Can you hear me, Emmanuel?
Yeah. I can hear you perfectly.
All right. The question is, has the foam been used for any plastic implants? And if yes, what are the benefits?
Oh, let's say, I'm not an expert in the plastic used with additive manufacturing, but I can say that the foam is useful when the bone can grow inside the foam. So there is some plastic that can stimulate the bone and grow, and some other plastic that do not. Okay. I can give you the example of the metal. If you create a foam made with cobalt chromium or made with stainless steel 316L, for example, you don't have bone and grow inside the foam, or actually, you have very low bone and grow inside the foam. And in that case, the foam is not so useful. So if you have to create a foam with plastics, you have to be sure that this foam can enhance the bone and grow. So you can have an effect using the foam. On the other hand, the only effect you can have is that you have a lighter implant because it is not 100% dense.
Just a little bit. We have done some animal studies on human beef and beef was mixed. The reason for that was that in all the when you mesh beef or the desired foam structure, you can incorporate sensors but also other biosol materials. So the hunting hybrids material implants, and I think that's the new way. Or you can also design plastic foam structure and do a coating on that, nano or bio coating, but then you would have an ideal implant in my eyes.
Yeah? Lauren, can you help me? Can you repeat?
Yes, an audience member was helping to answer your question. He had some experience with it. So no question at the moment.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and actually, if you can just speak to the laptop, it'll work.
I just had a follow-up question on the foam structure. Could you tell us a little more about how do you control the structure and the type of pores, you know, whether it's open or closed, and the dimensions of the pores in the foam? You know, what kind of process parameters would enable form those structures?
Okay, I cannot share all the information, but what I can say is that we design the foam. So the shape of the foam that you can see is came from a three-dimensional file. So we didn't use, let's say, tricks like the beam shut off and then turn on again in order to have a not complete melting of the metal. But we designed the foam. And talking about the control we made on the foam, we, before to qualify a foam, we perform several different tests. Some tests made with slicing the foam and with optical microscope observation. some other tests, for example, to evaluate the porosity and the pore size carefully, are done with micro CT scan to have a three-dimensional reverse engineering reconstruction of the foam.
Well, thank you, Emmanuel. I really appreciate you joining us remotely, and you definitely have a room full of people with 10 spaces, so we really appreciate your time today.
Thank you. Thank you for this possibility.
Okay. Thank you, Emmanuel. I'm going to end the broadcast now.
Okay.